There's history here.
And here.
There's history there.
History is everywhere.
Bought Jackson WellSprings, formerly Jackson Hot Springs, back in 1996. And it's been a labor of love for my husband for so many years. He's just kept on chipping away at it. Of course, the next year, right after we bought it, there was a huge flood. And it was practically wiped out. All the cabins were ruined, and the pool filled with mud, and the fences were all washed away. So we could have got it much cheaper if we'd waited just 6 months to buy it. But as it is, we just kept working away at it. Historically, the warm artesian waters of these springs were used by the Native Americans for healing and giving birth. It was a spiritual center, a trading center, and there were sacred burial grounds in the hills above the springs. People, Native Americans, came from all over to give birth in the water, and they considered it a special spiritual place where they would lay down their arms and they wouldn't fight, even though there were a lot of different tribes that didn't necessarily get along all the time. And the burial grounds in the hills above the springs were probably those who came to the springs to be healed, and not everybody got healed, right? So they needed somewhere to put them. In 1862, Eugenia Jackson dedicated the hot springs for natatorium and sanitarium purposes. So Ashland's history is intimately tied to health and healing. At the turn of the 20th century, there were 6 or 7 mineral spas in and around Ashland, each drawing upon the warm water that runs beneath the city. Prior to the Oregon Shakespeare and Southern Oregon College coming to town, the soaking industry was one of Ashland's major attractions. Lithia water was piped from Immigrant Creek to Lithia Park, the train station, the Mark Anthony Hotel, as well, allowing thousands of tourists to partake of the waters. Now, we know now that lithium is great for manic depression, so everyone in Ashland's pretty happy if they take a little lithium water now and then. So this is the natatorium, which you will also hear him speak about, built in 1908, which unfortunately now has a bank on top of it. It's very sad. The Hellman Bass, the Ashland Natatorium that later became Twin Plunges, Buckhorn Springs, Wagner Springs, and Jackson Hot Springs also all enjoyed notoriety between 1910 and World War II. So this is a picture of the inside of the natatorium. They had this huge slide and rings inside. Today, only Buckhorn Springs and Jackson Hot Springs are left to remind us of Ashland's rich history of health and healing. Both properties were celebrated as spiritual and birthing centers by First Nation tribes. Because you're going to hear more about Twin Plunges later, I just wanted you to see these slides because it's an amazing, beautiful place. And I'm kind of sad that it's a parking lot now. This is the outside of the two pools of Twin Plunges. Another great shot. So you can see all the bathing suits they put out there. Very stylish, right? So here's Jackson Hot Springs, circulation 1925. And the buildings don't look that different. We still have this whole area here, and it's now got a cafe, and we've got a lot of different things going on that I'll get into for you. But historically, in 1922, Ottinger built a swimming pool, campground, and a dance hall. Almost 100 years later, the naturally alkaline mineral hot springs waters continue to invite thousands of Oregon residents to partake of the waters. So it's amazing that it's still standing after all this time and floods and everything else. Here's a more updated picture. This is what the pool looks like now. And we continually have the water flowing through, and then we completely drain it and scrub it all out once a week and refill it so that we don't have to put a lot of chemicals in it. So when you go there, it's the natural water. It's very soft, and it feels really nice on your skin. And there's also a hot soaking pool, which is right here. You can see that lady in it. The water is very alkaline. It's about 9.2. So when you go in, it feels really soft and silky. It also has a lot of sulfur, though, and so we warn everyone to take off their jewelry and that everything will tarnish.
Do you have to cool it down?
No, unfortunately, originally, when it came out of the ground way back when, it was 104 degrees, but years ago, I believe someone tried to enlarge the hot springs and hit some cold water and it mixed. So now the water only comes out about 90 to 95 degrees. So we don't need to cool. In fact, we need to boost it up in the hot springs pool. And during the winter, we don't heat this pool, so it's more of a cold plunge. There is a holding pond that it comes out of the ground in, and you can see it if you go there. It's fenced off, but you can see the water bubbling up. And then we pipe it from there into the pool. It takes practically about 16 hours. It takes a very long time. We pull the plug, we drain the whole thing, and then after we clean it, it just takes all day long. And by late Monday night, it's full. And then we have ladies' night, and we have women only on Monday.
And you do this all the winter, too?
Sometimes in the winter, we don't because there's not very much use. But we always clean the smaller pool. So we've tried to keep some of the Native American history there. We had these nice designs painted. A little more North America, Pacific Northwest. So at one end, we have a Ganesha statue that was donated to us. And he's the remover of obstacles. So we have a cafe there now called the Ganesha Cafe. And the symbol of Ganesha is an Indian Hindu god who is the elephant with many arms. You can't see it very well on here, but I'll show you another picture of it in a second. And we've named our cafe Cafe Ganesha, and we serve Indian food there. So in order to keep the WellSprings going, it can't only be hot springs. We've got 30 acres and we've made many things. We've made it a campground, an RV park, a mobile home park, an event center. We have a big tent where we have concerts. We have two stages and the cafe, which is just small. So it's a huge operation. I don't think we could do it only on the spa. There's not enough to keep it going. So we continually try new things and it's a lot of fun. In the very back, there's a little spring where some water comes out of the ground, and we've created a mikveh. And this is a very beautiful pool with flow-through water. It's not very big. Those of you that understand the Jewish religion, a mikveh is a spiritual cleansing pool where historically the woman is to go and take a mikveh bath to cleanse herself after she's had her monthly cycle before she can be with her husband again. And a lot of times Jewish couples will come and schedule a mikveh before their wedding or different ceremonies. And so we have a pretty good Jewish community in Ashland that will use our mikveh, though you don't have to be Jewish to use a mikveh. And it's very private, it's fenced off, and we have private mikvehs there. And that's just the natural heat of the water that comes out of the ground. We don't change the temperature of that. So this shows a festival we had last year called Prana Fest. It was a yoga festival, and we had probably 3,000 people come and do yoga and eat organic food and stayed there for about 3 or 4 days. This happens to be, we converted the greenhouse for a yoga studio because there were so many people. This is Grandma Aggie Pilgrim, a Native American elder. She came out to the WellSprings and did a ceremony and a water blessing. We were very honored to have her. And this is a Rinpoche who just came out last month and did a ceremony. So we try to be a spiritual retreat center, but not just one religion, but many religions, and everyone's welcome. We tend to have an alternative culture. There's a lot of what you might call hippies that come there, but then there's everybody can come and pull up an RV and spend the night and soak. That's quite an evolution from way back when to now, and we're proud of it. We're happy that it's been here all these years and it's continuing. That's really all I have. Any questions?
Does the county give you any grief?
Oh, tons. Tons.
What's your secret?
Persistence, right? We have to keep on trying. Yes, after the flood and we had our cabins condemned, we wanted to remodel them, and they said, well, now you're in the floodplain. Now you can't remodel them. You have to tear them all out. So it's been hard. Once we got named floodplain, it stopped a lot of the building and remodeling. We had all these plans for condos and making it really nice. And so instead, it's still a trailer park and a campground and temporary structures like teepees and so on. Okay, well, thank you, everyone.
before we talk about the Medford Natatorium, I have a little bit of history to add about the Jackson Hot Springs, which you may not know. The first white man to claim the hot springs was a man named Platt. Claimed it in 1852, when, you know, just a few months after gold had been discovered. And he was in Jacksonville one day, gets a snootful, he's quite drunk, and he's challenging people to race, to a foot race. I don't know how he thought he could race if he's drunk. But he was very insulting to one gentleman by the name of Maynard. We don't have a whole lot of details, but Maynard apparently took umbrage at this and shot Mr. Platt dead. Platt was the first owner, was also the first murder victim in Jacksonville. And we don't know where Platt's buried, but Maynard was, you know, this was before there was any law in Jacksonville, but a jury was convened. And the stories are that Maynard was given a fair trial. He was given a defense attorney and a prosecuting attorney, and a jury of his peers found him guilty and hung him. So he's also Jackson County's first hanging, and he's buried on the grounds of the Presbyterian Church, of course, years before the church was built. But the Medford Natatorium, I don't know why, but Ashland beat Medford to having a natatorium. But you heard earlier that Ashland's Natatorium was built in 1908. Medford's wasn't built until 1910. And here's a construction picture of it. Had a steel frame. It was designed by Frank Clark, our sainted local architect. And it was a huge structure. It had 76,000 square feet on three different levels. And this is what it looked like. It was completed in the summer of 1910. It was built by a partnership of, I think, five different people who sunk a ton of money into this. And keep in mind that at the time, the town had a population of less than 10,000 people. But they were thinking, they were just sure that within 5 years, it was 25,000. It was Medford was on the slope of this huge real estate boom. The whole county was. In the 5 years, the population of the county quadrupled. And people in Medford were saying, we'll be San Francisco in 10 years. Didn't quite happen. Next slide. And there's another view of it. You can get an idea of where it was. This is 6th Street, coming this way. And the street that the Natatorium is actually on is Riverside. So it was sitting right about where the Red Lion, or whatever they call themselves now, where the Red Lion meeting rooms are, where their big convention rooms are. Next. And this is from the Sanborn maps of 1911, right after it was built. And you can get an idea of the layout. They had storerooms on the front floor, which initially were filled with a movie theater and a gymnasium and confectionery and a barber shop. They didn't last very long because that real estate boom I was talking about went bust in 1912, right after 2 years after it was built. But they had two different dance halls on the second floor, and one was called the Oriental Gardens, and there was an open air arbor so you could dance under the moonlight also, and in the basement were bowling alleys The newspaper stories say there were two bowling alleys, which I take to mean there were two lanes. Of course, this is long before automatic pin setters. There would have been a teenage boy setting up your pins. But in the basement there, initially there was bowling, a shooting gallery, and billiards. And next. And this is the swimming tank, which was huge. There's a story that you swam in Bear Creek water. It's not true. They actually advertised that you were swimming in drinking water. They got water, at the time the water came from Fish Lake, not Big Butte Springs, so it wasn't pure to 21st century standards, but it was drinking water. It was what people drank. And the way they didn't chlorinate the water, but the way they kept it clean was they would actually calculate the inflow of water by how many people were in the pool. So you knew it was safe mostly. Next. And this gives you another idea of where exactly it was. This picture was taken from the top of the Woolworths building. Of course, this is 40 years before Woolworths moved into that building. That's the high school, so it was very convenient to the high school, although I've never heard of any classes of any sort being given there. Next.
What sits in on the high school site now?
Lithia's tower. Lithia's. Yeah. And this is the pool hall, but judging from the light, it looks to me like it's not in the basement anymore. I've never heard about it being moved to the upstairs, but maybe it was. Don't know. Next. And now we're into the 20s, and about half of the pictures I have of the Natatorium come from the Gaylord collection. Winfield Gaylord moved here from the Midwest. He was a big wheel in the Socialist Party, but he was disgraced and ended up in Medford running a cycle shop. And this is the Natatorium. He's in the space where that movie theater was. And his daughter Beatrice ended up marrying Emerson Merrick, who was the son of one of the partners who built the Natatorium. And Fred Merrick was the partner who ended up with the Natatorium, because after the boom went bust, it wasn't making any money, and the other partners just kind of dropped out.
This would be a motorcycle?
Yeah.
Not a bicycle
shop.
No,
motorcycle shop. You'll see. Next. And there's just another shot. That's Mr. Gaylord there. Next. And here he is inside his shop. So you can see it wasn't all that great inside the Natatorium. It was kind of tawdry and wooden and ramshackle by our standards today. Next. Mr. Gaylord in a pensive moment. Next. And Merrick's, I don't know why they did this, but certainly it was to make money, just like today. You have to make the most of what you have. And one thing they had was a lot of real estate fronting on Bear Creek. The city of Medford had built an auto camp on the other side of Bear Creek in the late teens, and Merrick's followed suit in 1919. This picture, of course, is from the late 20s. Next. And they had a ton of cabins. At one time they had as many as 66 cabins. And I say at one time because the number fluctuated with the floods of Bear Creek. Next. 1924 washed away several of them. There was a gas station here. Next. And here's a plan where they're starting. No, well, this is from 19. This is from 1927. There was a 1924 flood, which washed away some of the cabins. You can see how close they were to the creek. And 1927 was the worst flood, which washed away dozens of cabins. Next. And you can see there one of the features of the auto camp was they started a store to serve the needs of the campers. The campers used the Natatorium facilities to bathe. Not they didn't bathe in the pool, but part of they had, I think, a couple dozen tubs. So it was not only you could swim there, you could also take your annual bath there. Another picture. Next. Next. And here's a picture of this is the 1927 flood, and you can see one of the problems they had, one of the problems any Natatorium, or most Natatoriums, many Natatoriums have when they're down by a creek. Next.
That's about like the WellSprings flood too.
Yeah.
1997.
And the year after that 27 flood, in 1928, they installed their first chlorinator, and then they started to use Swimmin' drinking water as their slogan. They were never terribly profitable.
And they dropped the name Natatorium for Merrick's?
Well, yeah, it was, I don't know why, but it was owned by the Merrick's, operated by the Merrick's. Why not? That's what it was called. In those days, you know, in before World War II, when you had really small towns and you knew the owners of businesses, having a business name wasn't all that important. Everyone knew everybody, everyone knew who ran what business, so that tended to be the only name you needed. Okay, so 1928. Then in 1930, they're starting to make a little bit of money. They're getting a little more profitable with the expansion of the park. And then the other partners from 1910 decide they want to get into this. They want to get some of some of the profits, even though they've been silent partners for 19 years, haven't taken part in all of the risk and all of the management. And so there's a big lawsuit, and every day there's more testimony in the newspapers, and the Merricks testify that we've never made any money, we're barely getting by here. And I think the suit was found in favor of the Merricks. Okay, next slide. 1931, they tried something new. This was a dance marathon. And I don't know how many couples started. It's in the newspapers. It's on my website. And they went on for 2 weeks. Next slide. 2 weeks later, they're down to 8 couples. No, this is only 171 hours. And why? This was 1931. It was the bottom of the dirty 30s. And the prize, think this, the winning couple, the losing couples got nothing. The winning couples got $1 for every hour they danced. So there were people with time on their hands. But they also got fed for all the time they were dancing. And they had to dance for 45 minutes, they could sleep for 15, but they had to eat standing up and they had to keep their feet moving while they were eating. And they sold tickets. People came to watch the dancers. Well, the idea was people would come to watch the dancers and listen to the music.
And there was betting going on too, and it says come and choose your couple.
Ah, could be.
I wonder if
Larry says there was betting going on.
I wonder.
I'm sure there was. I don't know. I get the impression from the newspapers that it wasn't terribly economically successful, and we never got a winner because after 2 weeks, the state government, the state labor board, came down and shut it down because these people were not getting paid overtime. And I kind of think that's a good thing because if you actually imagine what those people were going through, it must have been hell. Anyway, next slide. And where are we now? This is 1950. So you can see the auto camp is really taking over, or has taken over, because this is kind of the high point of Merrick's auto camp and the high point of the Natatorium. In World War II, the Natatorium was leased by the Army, used for training, teaching soldiers how to swim. And after that, the swimming tank was never used again. I think it was used in 1947 briefly for our Red Cross swimming lessons, but after that it just wasn't used. And the only part of the building that was used was the storefronts on Riverside and the dance halls upstairs, which got decreasingly less popular because the young kids like to go to the Dreamland dance hall on West Main in the Childers building instead, Walker's Dreamland. And the auto camp got less popular too because in the 40s, right after the war, lots of motels are being built on 99, brand new motels. Those horrible old motels, those were once brand new. And so Merrick's got less popular. And next picture. And in 1953, they start, the cabins are moved away. And these cabins are supposed to be spread all over the valley, 60 of them. I've never found one. If anyone knows where a cabin is, please ask your friends. I'd like to find one. I'd like to take a picture of one. The newspaper stories mention that three or four of them were taken out on Coal Mine Road. There's not a whole lot left, not a lot of people out there. I've poked around and haven't been able to find them. So
maybe like they would. There's some cabins out there that look like they've been around.
That would be a pretty fur piece to haul a cabin, but it's possible. But I'm deputizing you to find out. I'd like to know if some of them survive.
If they got their water all the way from Fish Lake, maybe.
Yeah. The next picture is the last one I have. This is the last picture taken of the Natatorium. It was torn down in 1956. It was a white elephant by then. Didn't really fit into the valley. Wasn't paying its way. So it was disassembled. And I imagine some of that lumber is in houses today. And the Red Lion went up. And that's all I have to say.
Twin Plunges, as it was known, actually started as a natatorium. And natatoriums were very, very prevalent. As Ben's indicated, Medford had one, they were all over. As opposed to auditoriums, most of it was water. It was obviously water-based. But the Twin Plunges, the Natatorium was actually established in 1909 by a consortium that built it, and it was going to be the biggest and best attraction in Southern Oregon. Actually, in 1929, when the market crashed, it just almost disappeared because the financing was no longer available, and it was rather dormant. In the 1930s, Billy Briggs, the local attorney, picked it up for tax default for the grand sum of $500. He tore down the structure, which was an auditorium, and actually received enough money out of those huge, huge beams that were overboard, that were sold in California, to recover his $500. But what he actually put it in what was subsequently known as the Twin Plunges. The structures were torn down, the two pools. The one of them was actually heated, and it originally was heated with sawdust. Then they went to oil, ultimately, and the sawdust was all over. And if many of you remember the Twin Plunges, actually the oak tank and steel was adjacent. And in those days, when we took it over in the 60s, they were still burning cars to take the upholstery out to recover the metal. And a lot of times, the residue would fly into the pool. We were taking slag out of the pool on a consistent basis.
Are these original tanks from the natatorium?
The pools are original, but the structure was over. Once the structure was down, and this particular pool was the hot pool, and where you see the Twin Plunges, that was actually the filtration, where it pumped through, filtered the water. This pool was what we call a fill and draw pool, and the water was released about every 3 or 4 days, and it was a holding tank where I don't know if you're familiar with the area, the food co-op sits right over where the pools actually were sitting. And what is now the parking lot was a holding tank or a reservoir. And two springs and one spring and two wells actually drained into it. And we held the water. And after 2 or 3 days, we had enough water just to withdraw the water from the pool and refill it. And that was the cold pool. And going back historically, Camp White was operated during World War II, and they would bring troops over to swim at the hot springs or at the plunges. So, generally speaking, this is about it. It's rather informative. If you've got any questions, just take a shot at me.
Were you part of it when the dome was put over it in the 60s?
Yeah, actually, that was done by one of the owners, the Dobsons. And Les decided that there wasn't enough to support the family by just the short season, and he decided to do a year round. And it was Minnesota Mining that furnished a mylar pool, or bubble, as it were. As a matter of fact, it was featured, I think, in Popular Science at that particular point. The only problem was the plastics weren't that sophisticated, and the chlorine dissipation from the inside and some of the shingles flying through the roof and did it in within about a year. But Minnesota Mining did replace it, but it lasted 2 years and that was it. It just wasn't.
I was attending Southern Oregon and we were taking swimming classes down there in the middle of winter, which was quite exciting.
Great.
To be able to swim in the wintertime.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up. Prior to Southern Oregon College building its pool, all the swimming classes, Bob Bennett and Bev used to bring their classes down. We were utilized as their swimming facility.
How long did you own it?
From 66 till the closure in 78. Actually,
so
over the period.
You bought it from the Dobsons?
Pardon?
You bought it from the Dobsons?
That's correct. Yeah, as a matter of fact, you obviously know some of the history of the Dobsons. Lydia Dobson was living in Southern Cal, and we were living in Redondo Beach at the time. And she and her daughter Sylvia came over to look us over to make sure we were the right fit for the pool. But
how did it do financially? Did you make a living? Did you make a good living?
Well, actually, we were known as the biggest babysitting service in Ashland. I mean, for 75 cents, they could swim from 10 to 10. And of course, my wife had the swimming classes, and during the open season, of course, there was a lot of preparation time in the spring. The pools had to be painted each year, and it took something like 25 gallons of aluminum paint to paint the pools.
Did you do it?
Pardon?
Did you do it yourself?
Oh, you bet. The two of us did it. As a matter of fact, some of you may remember the high dive. And we looked at that high dive and being a little bit more safety conscious, people were diving into about 4 feet of water. So after a windstorm, we asked Oak Tank and Steel just to cut the high dive out and remove it. And we felt a lot better. And some of you may remember the spin top, which was in the cold pool, which was a contrivance brought down from a pool in Eugene, which, getting back to the Dobson, one of their daughters owned up at Junction City.
So somebody called and said they had a high school prom night there. Mm-hmm. Were there other kinds of activities that the
schools? Oh yeah, they have beauty queen contests. Right, and 4th of July, everybody came and took a dip, and there were all kinds of swimming contests. As a matter of fact, we featured one time that somebody could walk across the pool. So a bunch of our lifeguards got in the pool, they ducked, and one of my kids walked on their shoulders across the pool. No, we had a lot of fun doing it.
Were you a swimmer, or?
Pardon?
Were you a competitive swimmer?
No, I wasn't, but my sons actually all were pretty good swimmers. As a matter of fact, the middle son would enter some of the, and without even training, he'd come up first or second most of them.
The beauty contest. So you had so how many people participated? Was there a judging panel? Who won? Was there prizes?
Well, actually it was pretty well attended. As a matter of fact, one of the winners of the beauty queen contest was Gertie Hess. She was the wife of subsequently the postmaster. But it was pretty well attended. As a matter of fact, the beauty queen contest attracted people from Montague, from Medford, from all over the whole area, really.
Hi, Al. I used to live on your block in Ashland.
Okay.
Beauty contest, and I remember she ended up marrying Keith Henty with Jefferson Public Radio.
But I'm really appreciative of being here because I'm learning more about the history, and quite frankly, the relationship between Jackson Hot, which is now WellSprings, was pretty great. As a matter of fact, my middle son managed it for about 3 years when the Sages were actually running the operation, but he managed the pool and the snack bar, as it were. Yeah, and the Sages actually moved up from Hilt, which was a company town, which was owned actually by fruit growers. They still have a lot of timber holdings, but they used to make their fruit crates for their oranges down there.
One of the pools was heated and one was not?
That is correct. The one of them, when Billy Briggs bought it, he put up the filtration system. And as I say, it was heated, originally was sawdust, which was a mess, and subsequently they changed the oil. But the one was heated, the other one was unheated. And it was filled, and every 3 or 4 days, we dropped the water, refill it again.
And what temperature was the hot?
We try to keep it between 76 and 78 degrees.
Who named it? Did Billy Briggs name it?
Pardon?
Did Billy Briggs name it?
Yeah, Billy Briggs named it Twin Plunges, right. As a matter of fact, my kids used to refer to the Twin Plungers.
How many lifeguards did you have?
Well, actually, it's interesting, you guys. I did most of the when things were slow, I did most of the lifeguarding and maintenance. My wife did the swimming teach. But we had 2 and 3 lifeguards, depending on the activity. And it was kind of intriguing because when we first moved here, there was a little bad blood between Jackson Hot and Twin Plunges because they were competitors. First thing I did, I went down and saw Wallace Smith, and when they were slow, they'd send the lifeguards up for us to use. We were slow, they'd send them down. So we had great cooperation after that.
What got you into the idea of wanting to buy this?
Well, interesting question.
You bought an icon.
Pardon?
You bought an icon.
Well, actually what happened, both my wife and I were involved in outdoor activity, but we were living down in Redondo Beach, and my oldest son was first grade, just turning six, and when he was tasked, in case of atomic attack, dive under a desk, I looked at my wife and I said, if the world were to be given an enema, the syringe would be stuck in L.A., let's get the hell out of here. So we moved up, never looked back. As a matter of fact, my boss at the time, I was working for L.A. County with the Department of Charities doing fraud investigation. He says, hey, look, I'll put you out of here. If it doesn't pan out, come back. And the reason we picked it up, there weren't any jobs available, unless you were a doctor, a dentist, or an architect, whatever.
What year?
And when we moved up here.
What year? 66?
That's what we bought the business in order to move up here.
Oh.
But we thoroughly enjoyed it.
In what year?
1966.
66?
Right. Well, actually, my wife went back to school, to SOSC, which is now University of Southern Oregon, to do her master's thesis in outdoor ed. And since we had both done a little research on it, Frank Haynes, who was a prof at the time of Northwest History, said, why don't you use this as a basis for your master's thesis? And since this was available, my daughter-in-law took the master's thesis, pirated a bunch of pictures one Christmas, and as a surprise, sent me this book, and I said, there's just too much history just to let go. And I subsequently, with some additions, published it. But it is available at the Historical Society if you're interested at all.
When you closed it because of economic reasons?
Well, actually, we were highly subsidizing it the last 5 years. And of course, the city was anxious to build a municipal pool. And we tried to offer it to the city. It says, look, you can resurrect it. As a matter of fact, the city of Portland, the Columbia Pool, was roughly the same vintage. They resurrected it, put a top over it, and it's still operational. The city was so anxious to have their own pool, and somehow or other, this is a little past history. I was in a council, I guess I said too many no's, that we couldn't work. I tried to offer it to the county, and the county was very interested, but the city says, no, this is our domain. We want to do our own thing. As a matter of fact, Jim Ragland, who was a council member, tried the last shot. The city yards on A Street were being abandoned. They moved out on B Street and East Main. And I suggested, look, let's get an appraisal, let's swap the thing. I'll do a storage thing and you can do what you want with the pools. But it never came off.
So you sold it to a developer then?
No, actually, we sold it to what was then Heritage Bank. And the bank built there. And of course, I don't know if you remember, they went bankrupt and closed the store. FDCA shut them down, and subsequently it was acquired by Valley of the Rogue Bank, which then bought by Umpqua. But it was a succession of banks.
And they're sitting right on top of the Plunges.
Well, actually, where the bank is was actually the structure, and where the co-op is now located, they're sitting actually right over the pools. And the parking lot was a holding tank for the water. And unfortunately, the water source is just running merrily down Ashland Creek at this point without being utilized.
So what did you do after you sold it?
Oh, you name it, I've done it. Well, actually, I was involved as a reservist in the military, and then subsidized the pool. In the winter time, I'd go on short active duty tours.
The
to get us over the hump. As a matter of fact, I worked up at Mount Ashland, and I don't know if any of you knew Tim Yockey, who did some of the glasswork, some beautiful glasswork, did the resurrection at the Baptist Church, which is now the Cabaret Theater, and also did some work at the Methodist Church, as well as many, many other churches, and some of this stuff is all over. And Tim and I worked up at Mount Ashland. God, I was lift operator. I worked for Harry and David. I worked for Soprosa, you name it, just to keep things. That was Helman Bath. Right. As a matter of fact, a lady by the name of Eggert, she and a daughter owned it, and they had a place out on the coast, but in the summertime, they'd come back and they used it for their own purposes. As a matter of fact, Ellie Egger invited me down to the pool. I never did get down there. I never saw the inside, but that's still, it's still there. Helman Bath is actually geothermal. It's a natural hot spring. As a matter of fact, there was another hot spring. The greenhouses, Jack Williams had somebody drill a well, and Studebaker drilled a well, and it came out warm, which actually took care of his hothouses. Yeah, there were a lot of geothermal springs. As a matter of fact, as Ben pointed out, they've cooled down, but years ago, they had a holding tank, and most of these people, rather than paying to go to Jackson Hot, they'd sneak in skinny dip down at the holding pond. Buckhorn Springs?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Actually, when we first came up here, we were looking at it as a possibility, and there was a chiropractor that had a practice out there. The name escapes me at this particular point, but it was a healing spot, and the chiropractor together, and subsequently, well, it's still operating. Buckhorn Spring has weddings out there, and they have all kinds of activity. But thank you very, very much for having me. And enjoy it. And I want to